In the tradition of St. Louis de Montfort, let us pray, Hail Mary. In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Ghost. Amen. Hail Mary, full of grace, the Lord is with thee. Blessed art thou amongst women, and blessed is the fruit of thy womb, Jesus. St. Joseph. In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Ghost. Amen. With all the things that are going on in the world and in our own backyards, it might be a temptation of ours to despair of what's going on. So today it might be a good time to speak on that supernatural virtue of hope. The three theological virtues being faith, hope, and charity. Right now, when it comes to faith, we know that it is the supernatural, this ascent of the mind to those truths proposed by our belief, revealed by God, who can neither deceive nor be deceived, and proposed by Holy Mother Church as truths to be believed. Now, when it comes to that supernatural hope, we hope through the promises of Almighty God and through the merits of our Lord who suffered and died for our salvation, that those who knock and those who seek shall find salvation. Now, when we talk about the virtue of hope, it might be helpful to distinguish it from the two opposite extremes, which are sins, namely that of presumption and of despair. Now, I'm throwing a whole bunch of abstract terms over here, so let's flesh them out a little bit. Presumption, the sin of presumption. We'll call this sin the sin of Bob. Okay, so Bob the presumptuous goes and sins with the idea, well, God is merciful and he will forgive me, therefore let me go out and commit some murder and adultery and a whole bunch of, let's bank robber, let's do that kind of thing too, might as well die rich, things like that. When we have someone who is committing the sin of presumption, we're not talking about the virtue of hope, where God promises forgiveness to the repentant sinner. We are talking about someone who is taking advantage of God's mercy and, in a certain sense, showing him contempt. If you find someone, the kindest, sweetest person in the world, let's say your sweet Aunt Bertha, and presumptuous Bob goes and takes sweet Aunt Bertha for a ride and says, I'm going to go smack you in the face, and then I want you to forgive me. And then once you forgive me, I'm going to do it again, because, why stop at one? And then let's do it a couple more times. I just want to see how far I can go before Aunt Bertha gets mad. Now, as nice as Aunt Bertha is, Aunt Bertha's got limits, right? Okay, and when it comes to God, God will not be mocked, right? So we have to be careful. Don't fall into that sin of presumption. Don't be like presumptuous Bob. We want to be careful that we don't unduly provoke God. Now, that having been said, if we fall into a sin, and let's say that you committed all 10, or you violated all 10 commandments multiple times yesterday, okay? You did all these things, and you're feeling quite horrible. You get on your knees, you repent of those sins, you get yourself into the confessional, you confess your sins, okay? Now, there is a big difference between the one that has true contrition and has hope that God will be merciful to me, because now I wish not just simply to have these sins forgiven, I don't want to have anything to do with it from henceforth. And I pray that God keep me nice and strong so that I don't fall. Do you see how different this might be from presumptuous Bob's attitude? Rather than simply, I'm going to smack you, and I want you to forgive me, and then once you forgive me, I'm going to smack you again, and then I'm going to ask you to forgive me again, because I know you will, because you're Aunt Bertha. Okay? We have to make sure that, you know, so God is merciful. So if we come with true contrition for our sins, and that firm purpose of amendment, I don't want to do this anymore, and I know I'm not perfect, I know I'm weak, but if I turn to God and I ask Him for that grace, God will give me all the graces I need to save my soul. Okay, so let's leave presumptuous Bob over there, and we'll move on now to the second sin, that of despair. Okay, so despair is the polar opposite of presumption, but no less malicious. And here, we are talking about a sin where my sins are so great, God can't forgive me. I have done so many things. Let's say that you broke all 10 commandments multiple times yesterday. There is no one in my family that's even come close to that kind of malice and wickedness. Not even Mary Magdalene, before she became saint, can brag about committing all, going against all 10 commandments on the same day multiple times. And yet, here I am. So how can God forgive me? So let's give a name for this despair. Let's call them, you have those Debbie Downers, so let's call them Debbie the Despairer, okay? Now, Debbie the Despairer is sawing off the branch of mercy that God is extending to her. So let's say that she did, in fact, multiple times a day, commit sins against all 10 commandments. Debbie the Despairer doesn't need to despair that God won't forgive her. In fact, all that God is doing is reaching out, calling her by name. And when she says, God can't forgive me, what she is doing is closing her heart off to the graces that God is offering. Just as with you have presumptuous Bob, Debbie the Despairer is also cutting herself off from the graces that God is giving her. God can't save me, and implicitly she is saying, God is not able to save me. God, who is omnipotent, who has created me out of nothing, who has gone through all the trouble of suffering and dying on the cross to save me from my sins, doesn't care about me. And even if he did, he wouldn't be able to save somebody as wretched as I. Now, we can take Debbie the Downer here and pull her aside and say, look, Debbie, I know you're down and you've been down for quite a while, but here's the thing. All of us, without exception, have that fallen human nature. Okay, so maybe you broke a couple of records yesterday with what you were doing, but again, there are a lot of saints in heaven that did a lot of bad things, and God forgave them, not because they were really good at falling into sins, but because they were really good at getting on their knees. asking for forgiveness, going into the confessional and confessing like there's no tomorrow. So Debbie the Downer, cheer up, get yourself to confession, and don't have any kind of doubts that God can't forgive us. So these are the two extremes. You have the sin of presumption, and you have the sin of despair. And we have to be very careful to avoid both extremes. Now, that supernatural virtue of hope is founded on the most, the strongest foundation possible, the promise of God. God, who is truth himself, has said, come to me, all ye who labor and are heavily burdened, and I will give you rest. He's told us, knock and you shall seek. Knock and it shall be opened to you. Seek and you shall find. God has told us numerous times that he desires not the death of the sinner. Don or Debbie, are you listening? He desires not the death of the sinner, but that they be converted and live. You know, why would God go through all the trouble of creating you if he wanted to go ahead and just pull the lever and then yank you down into hell? He doesn't want that to happen, and so he's going to throw you as many graces as he can. And because he's God, he can do quite a bit. So throughout these tumultuous times, we've got quite a bit going on out there. You turn on the TV, you turn on the news, it's in your face, and it's everywhere. But we have to remember, at the end of the day, there is one thing that is important. The one thing that is important is that there is one God, and we need to make sure that when we die, we are with him. And no matter how bad it looks outside, whether you have a literal World War III, a zombie apocalypse put together with a whole bunch of other things, or just kind of your general average day of chaos and doom, however it might be outside, if we know that God not only has everything under control, but that he has won the final battle, we know how the book ends. Skip to the end in Apocalypse there, and you can find out how it all ends. And I'll give it away for you guys. God wins. So no matter how bad it is outside, we have to keep that virtue of hope. We have to make sure we're not getting despondent. We're not getting ourselves... What's the point of keeping up the faith? What is the point of doing all these difficult things when things are so bad? I'll tell you why. Because you don't want to be on the losing side. You know, I don't know about you, but I'm a sore loser. I don't like to be on the losing team, especially if God's on the winning one. So make sure, when it comes to these things, you keep that supernatural virtue of hope. May our Blessed Mother help us to instill this virtue in our hearts and to increase it every single day. And God bless you. In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Ghost. Amen.
Dominus
Sobis.
Amen. Thank you. Dominus Obispum et Spiritu Vostrum. Amen.
Blessed art thou